The following is an encore presentation of New Expressions.
And it's 10:05 on a beautiful Friday morning. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, I've got coffee, and I've got company. And joining me via Zoom, my compadre, Craig Stevens. Good morning, sir. How are we?
Can I just say, I love being your compadre.
Amen. You're my compadre, my amigo.
And here is
my Robin.
And interestingly, intriguingly, even though we're on Zoom, neither of us are in our pajamas.
No, but you being my Robin, you're probably wearing tights at the moment. Can't see them, but I'm sure they're present. I've got my cape on, you've got your tights. Hey, hang on, I'll make you my Tonto. That way you can have a feather in your head. There you go.
I just want to commend you on your haircut. It's looking fantastic today.
Okay, so now we're turning to Tom and Jerry now. Abbott and Costello. I got it. Standing Laurel. Oh, my goodness. It is New Expressions. No need to introduce the show. People know, oh, this is that New Expressions show. Goodness. Oh, but we're here today. We got an hour to brag on God. And we're going to make the most of it. Amen?
Yeah, come on. And it is that, you know, being on the Central Coast, we have literally a great target over the Central Coast that heaven looks down on to pour out goodness and favor and blessing and providence. And you know, we are so blessed.
Amen.
And, mate, I don't know about you, but there are clouds in the sky up here at the lake at the moment. You were saying how the sun is shining. Well, it kind of is. It's coming through a little.
Beautiful out there.
You've got plenty of sunshine up there, have you? Down in the...
It's beautiful.
There we go.
You should hop in the car, come down, and we... Yes. I think you should try to get here.
I'm just going to stay on radio for the moment. This is the joy of live radio. Praise
Amen.
God.
And yes.
We've got, as you said, an hour to brag on Jesus, on his kingdom, and what kingdom stuff is happening here in this glorious region. A great, 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 great friend of mine and great leader and great fathering leader in the region, Pastor Tony Ray, Community Church. We are super excited that you are our guest again today. Thanks for coming.
Amen. Thanks, Tony.
Thank you, Evan. I appreciate that. It's now the three amigos.
That's right. That's right.
we will need to get hats for next time.
But
just on what's been happening now with our ability to laugh and to share, you know, the joy that it is in knowing people, and not just knowing of people, but knowing people and connecting. And the joy of the Lord is not, it's not just a laughy thing. Mm. You know, that certainly can be expressed in great, you know, laughter and,
yeah.
But the joy of the Lord is something so deep, and it really, to me, it's a bit like, you know, people do these cleansing things, you know, where they take certain things and that cleanses the body of stuff and that. Mm. I think when the joy of the Lord, you know, washes up from within, and that's where it's got to be, from our spirit. It's got to come from our spirit if it's going to be the joy of the Lord. If it's going to be real joy in a biblical sense, it's got to come up from our spirit. But it's just like one of those cleansing things that just can wash, you know, anxieties and fears and all that. There's lots of other stuff that can do biblically, but I just think joy, it's like that effervescence, oh, I don't know, whatever the word is.
Effervescence.
That's it. It just rises up within us, and it can really shift. It can shift attitudes. It can shift perspectives. And I think it can do it spiritually too.
Yeah.
You know, where there's a great well of the joy of the Lord really capturing believers and them living out of that. And that's not laughing everything off, and that's not, you know, it's much deeper than that, much more powerful, but it is a cleansing thing. The joy of the Lord, I believe, is a cleansing thing that can actually allow us then to be able to hear what the hope is, or what the love that we need to receive is, or how we need to give it, you know. Anyway, just some thoughts there.
Beautiful thoughts. It's medicine. It's like it's medicine for your soul. It's like it, and I agree with you. It's a, it releases a capacity to renew your mind.
It releases
a capacity for renewal, like in your spirit, in your soul. It brings newness. I totally agree. And I want to just distinguish for a moment on Pastor Tony, because you brought this thing up. And so this is all on you. But but you know that I wonder if if the listeners today actually know and can bear witness to what the joy of the Lord is in comparison or separate from joy or the sense of joy that I might have, you know, because there is joy that you have in your soul, in your flesh, and in your existence. There is a joy that's a natural joy, but the joy of the Lord, I just want to just drill down on that. That is a uniquely that is a unique thing that you can actually bear testimony to. Wow, that is not of me. That is not in my grid. That is actually something in my spirit that is of the Lord. Your thoughts on that, Pastor Tony?
Yeah, look, I think I experienced some of that. Just to give a practical example, I can be a little bit of a stressor sometimes. Not a perfectionist, but I really, you know, you really hope that things go well and you plan and you operate and that sort of thing. But so often in life, things just go pear-shaped. You know, they don't go the way they were. God taught me, and I did express this, you know, in a laugh. God released in me when stuff just wasn't, you know, I had this phrase of saying, "We got to laugh or you got to cry." And the Lord led me into, "Well, I'll laugh." And I wasn't laughing because it was fun, you know, what I was experiencing, and from the big to the minor. But there was almost a sense of bubbling up, and I would laugh, and it would be a circuit breaker because it was that joy of God in me that was trying to do something, trying to protect me from my own self-judgment or my own, you know, poor perspectives on what might be taking place. And so I guess I just learned a little bit, you know, by experience that it's, and I'd rather laugh than cry.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes it's very important to cry, but I'd rather laugh and that be an expression of God working in me to just release, to circuit break, to get me off the treadmill or off the disappointment or off the stress or the challenge or the confusion even, Lord. You know, you can really get your head in a muddle sometimes, and I just think the joy of the Lord can pop out, can bubble up, and just, and really, I mean, this is not theological talk, you know, but bubble away some of the stuff that can really block up the well of the Spirit coming through. Mm. And wherever you see joy connected to big things like, you know, love, peace, and joy, and, you know, that sort of thing, it's got to be important, you know. So I think it's worth allowing, or at least asking God, how that joy can bubble up in us, in you, to serve a purpose. You know, I mean, God does all things for a purpose. Yeah. You know, even if that purpose is just to have some fun with us, because I think He likes that too.
Yes.
You know. So anyway, that's just the off the head, you know, off the top of the head. What's there?
Yeah. I think a lot of us kind of forget that humor is actually free. freely given, free to use, free to enjoy, and I don't know, but I guess I don't know. I don't know if there's a stigma out there that Christians can't be funny, and I do mean funny, ha ha, funny, because I know some funny Christians. But I consider myself, a walking sitcom. So as I explained to myself to my wife before we married, that if you marry me, you got to understand you're marrying a sitcom because I like to have fun. I do. I genuinely like to have fun. It's nothing more infectious than a joyous atmosphere. It breaks down barriers. It promotes camaraderie. It brings people closer together. And you work better in an environment that's full of joy. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if it's coming from the Spirit, not just the laughy bit, if it's coming from the Spirit, which it can be, you know, in all sorts of ways, like by lighthearted joking and stuff.
Mm.
You know, in James it says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Consider it pure joy. Well, I'm not laughing about that, but boy, I know within that, because the Word of God tells me that, considering trials and stuff pure joy has got to have some much deeper spiritual benefit for us.
Mm.
You know, to take that position of joy when we, you know, because it's, you know, James is saying, consider it, you know, pure joy when you face many trials.
Yes.
You know, there's got to be some power being released in that stance of considering, you know, letting the joy of the Lord be our strength.
Mm.
You know, take the Old Testament.
Yeah. It's a defense mechanism as well. I mean, you know, in that seed time and harvest, in that time are you waiting? And it's going longer than you would hope. You're like, hang on, this is going too long. You know, how do you sit and how do you wait? I mean, do you sit in the corner all grumpy-faced and lemon and soured about it? Or do you actually just, you know, have joy in the middle? Do you have joy while you're waiting?
This is the hope-filled gospel. This is what I'm hearing. I'm hearing the hope-filled gospel. You know, that there is cause for joy. And sometimes that cause you can see around you, but sometimes that cause is the intentional source of the Holy Ghost within you. Because his kingdom is a matter of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy
Spirit. Holy Spirit. Amen.
That's right.
And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy.
Hey, Pastor Tony, we could stand around and talk about it, or we could just do it. Why don't you? Because this idea that you captured my attention when you were speaking earlier is that yes, it's from a deep place, and that there's a witness by your Spirit. This is God. This is that. And I thought the word circuit breaker that you just mentioned a moment ago. Mm-hmm. I thought, gee, isn't that what our societies are calling out for in the context of lockdown? You know, in the we're struggling in terms of people who aren't walking in the full story of the kingdom, pre-Christians in particular, who are wrestling with these sorts of dramas across the world. We actually, you know, there is a circuit breaker that's available. It's called the joy of the Lord. Would you just mind praying that over our listening audience?
Sure.
Yeah. Kick us off this morning. You know what? Let's just break all the circuits right now. Release the joy of the Lord. Encounter the hope-filled gospel and see what God can do.
Yeah. Oh, Lord Jesus, we do thank you that the fruit that we are to bear, and this is not we pick some of the fruits, it's a singular, it's all the fruit, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
But this particular aspect of joy, you know, because joy comes in the morning. You know, we hear the scriptures say, the joy of the Lord is our strength. You know, consider it all joy. You know, that fruit of the Spirit, Lord, I ask for it to manifest, Lord Jesus, in our lives, physically manifest. And if that means we will laugh, then wow, go with it. Let it soak through that laughter that might come. But, Lord, I ask that you would release in our inner being, right from deep within our spirit, a genuine understanding that we have joy no matter what.
Hallelujah.
And, Lord, that joy allows some space in our minds to break that thought pattern, to be that circuit breaker, to break so our mind can be renewed. It can be renewed by gospel truth. It can be renewed by the word of God. But something needs to break what's binding us if our minds are confused or hurting or angry or whatever it is. I ask, Lord Jesus, from your grace and your mercy to bubble up within us that joy that can release us into greater understandings and greater freedoms that we might ever know. And, Lord, I ask in Jesus' name, because he deserves the glory and he wants us to receive our inheritance, what we have in him, and joy is one of those things. So I release it in Jesus' name now, and I ask that we might beautifully receive it. And may it be expressed in whatever way, Lord, you want it to be in our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Pastor Tony Ray on the New Expressions program. There you go, just releasing joy all over the shop. Well done. What? This idea of the joy of the Lord, that's the witness. That's the witness, listeners, today. Not that I am experiencing a measure of joy. Actually, this is of the Lord. The Lord God has placed within me a joy. And that idea of it being a circuit breaker, Pastor Tony, I just said to you off air, my faith is through the roof on this. I can see people's circuits breaking left, right, and center. You know, those circuits, the negative mindsets. This is too hard. This is too difficult. I'm struggling. I'm not going to make it. I don't know what to do. I can just see those circuits just snapping left, right, and center as the joy of the Lord is deposited anew or bubbles up from within, because this is the kingdom of God that we bear witness to, isn't it?
Amen. And it was right from the beginning, well, not from the beginning, when Christ came to the earth. What did the angels, you know, proclaim? Don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people.
Come on.
I don't think it's just talking about just general happiness.
No.
But this is about, this Christ that is coming is going to be the gateway, the sacrifice, the, you know, the the wonder that is going to allow, you know, much greater experiences of the kingdom of God.
Come on.
You know, because of what he releases in the earth. You know, and there it is, the angel's saying, you know, it'll cause great joy for all the people.
Wow.
So it's, you know, in many ways, I think it's not just for us as believers. I think God's wanting to work in everybody's life, obviously, and he wants to call people to himself and for them to experience that forgiveness and love and salvation that's offered. Mm. But I think sometimes even those that are outside belief, they can experience this. I've seen it. People pop, you know, and just for some reason there's something that just gets released in them, and I think that's the grace of God, you know, working in their lives so that they don't end up, you know, somewhere in a dark place that you know, could potentially end things for them in a way that God would never want, you know, for them. You know, so I just think, you know, part of the declaration of Jesus being born was great joy. it was gonna hit the world, you know, and I guess it's, you know.
So I'm so thankful for you drawing that link. Because I hadn't naturally just made that link, and there it is. It's actually the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Mm-hmm.
And in, you know, when we are saved by grace through faith in the Son of God and what he has done, the presence of Jesus resides within us. That very same thing that the angelic hosts announced would bring great joy. There it is within us. So almost the residual provision of joy that resides in the hearts of every man, woman, boy, and girl, the believers in the Son of God, that joy is an access point to break circuits. So I tell you what, if that's not revelation, there's a book in that right now. Maybe someone ought to get to work and start scribbling down a book on that.
Yeah.
That's good. That's a helpful word. That's a word in season.
Well, listen what Jesus says in John chapter 15. We've been in there a bit, haven't we? Yep. Verse 11, it says, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete.
Come on.
Because, again, the true effects and the true experience of joy can't be fully experienced outside Jesus. Yeah. You know, it can escape into the community, it can escape into people that don't believe, and it can powerfully operate in their lives. But the full joy is for those that have entered into Christ, who is, you know, the full expression of all great things.
Love it. Love it.
So, yeah.
Well, there's the assignment for the listener audience today is find someone, lay hands on them and release a great measure of joy in their spirit. I do that COVID safe, by the way. That's the people that you like in your house. You
put your mask on, rubber gloves, everything, PPE. Yeah.
Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Isn't it interesting? There it is in John 15. Was it last night at the
prayer team
that we were into that? A number of people had some insights, some revelation. God was speaking to us from that passage. A wonderful, wonderful text of the kingdom of God come, how it manifests, what it looks like. And there it is, abiding in him and him in us, that his joy might be complete. Praise God. Pastor Tony, I want to pivot a little and just ask, you know, you have postured yourself in a sonship journey for many years, as have I, in your context, John Alley is a great apostolic voice in our nation and beyond the nation, into many nations. I've joined in that journey with John as well over recent years. And, you know, there is this great grace afforded the likes of you and some of the other sons walking with John to sit at the apostles' feet and to understand the apostles' teaching and really to manifest the Acts 2 scriptures, you know, and so I wonder if you might just talk into that for a moment, the idea of the posture of sonship and hearing from the apostles and what we're sensing in these days as well. Can we pivot into that space for a moment?
Yeah, sure. I mean, there's sort of two different things there, or two compatible things there. That the sonship issue, and John would say, you know, everyone needs to be a son or a daughter to somebody, and everyone needs to have a son and a daughter then. Yeah. It's this relational, you know, the way that the kingdom is connected. You know, the way the church is to be connected, you know, one to another is very much in this. And it's not like, you know, and you have to sort of keep explaining this to people. It's not like the old shepherding movement where it was really controlled. And, you know, a genuine loving father to a son or a daughter is not going to try and control them in any way, shape or form. They will be speaking, and they'll speak truth, and they may have to say some harsh things at times, but it will never be about control. It will be about guiding towards the son or the daughter discovering who they really are and what their place is and what their giftings are and all that, you know, that hopefully then that too they pass on, you know, to their son or daughter, you know, spiritual son or daughter. But it is such a wonderful thing. It the whole submission thing, you know, we submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. You know, so I've never felt as a son, you know, to a spiritual father, John Alley, you know, I've never felt that I've been pushed, coerced, commanded, you know, in any direction. But boy, have I felt loved and guided and you know, shepherded, strengthened properly. Mm. In a journey of, you know, pastoral ministry can be pretty tough sometimes, you know. There's that thing called sheep bite that can be, you know, pretty nasty, and you get an infection in that, and you got some problems. You know, so there's, in a sense, there's a doctoring role that a father has as well, you know, to patch up some of the wounds and things. So I think that's a really important aspect of the way apostolic Christianity expresses itself in relationships, you know, in mutually beneficial relationships, you know, with fathering and mothering and all that. The other issue there is apostles, you know, and which in a sense are an ultimate fathering role, you know, an expression of Christ, mm-hmm. one of the fivefold, an expression of Christ that is wanting to mature the church, you know, bring it into its destiny and its power and its proper functioning. I think that the two go hand in hand in a sense, because once apostles are identified, there is a need to submit to them. And again, it will not be based on a power paradigm. It's not, nothing of the kingdom is based on a power, earthly, our concepts of earthly power paradigms. It's based on an authority and a recognition of calling and place within the kingdom. And when you find those relationships, boy, you don't feel, you know, you don't feel crushed. You don't feel, oh, expectations that I've got to do this now. If I'm recognizing John Alley as my apostle, that oh, now I've got to do this and I've got to do that. There's a whole lot of stuff I want to do. Just like our relationship with God, you know, we want to do stuff out of love and that. And so it's not a power structure. It's an authority structure. It's a flow. At the last summit, he gave an example of, you know, the stuff that we want, the good water that we want to come out of the tap, you know, you turn that tap on, you've got to be trusting, and it'll only come out with good water if the piping goes back to the proper source. You know, now, I think apostles play a role of that, you know, a connecting. It's not that believers cannot go to Jesus themselves. They absolutely can. Everybody's got extreme, you know, Hebrews tells us, boldly approach the throne of grace. You can go straight in. You don't crawl in. You walk straight in because you're a son or daughter. Yet there is a flow of grace and power of resource that comes through that pipe work that gets connected back to apostles and through apostles and then, you know, back to Christ himself. That when hopefully the tap is turned on for whatever flow a believer needs or a church congregation needs, that flow comes out strong, powerful and effective. But it does rely on connections. If that pipe is just stuck in the wall and that pipe's not connecting to anything, the tap can look as nice and shiny and beautiful and look wonderful, but it's not going to do the job. It's not going to give life-giving water. You know, it's not going to give the empowering that's needed to come out of it. So it's important to what we're connected to. Mm. And part of restoration of apostles and prophets and pastors, teachers, evangelists, the whole thing to mature the body, it's about creating those right connections. And I was with someone just the other day and they were talking about alignment, very much about alignment. But not just, you know, even John Alley would say back in the day when he was coming into this understanding before he was, you know, called to be an apostle, you know, you can have a notion of it and then you think, oh, well, yeah, let's get the diagram in place. Yeah, okay, so they relate to them and they relate to them, that position. Again, that's all worldly stuff that we fall back to that because it's somewhat easy to do. Mm. It's not about that. It's not about having the diagram and having, oh, right, we've got the apostle in place now. So we're set now. So off we go on our own merry way and do whatever we want. No, the relating to an apostle is very much, as always with everything, a relational experience and release of the kingdom. And it's there to be explored. You know, I don't know the depths of John's knowledge and him, the grace that he carries. I'm learning into it. You know, I'm leaning into it. I want that. Doesn't mean I don't lean into Christ. Christ is the absolute ultimate. But I need to see it expressed in flesh and blood as well. I need to see Christ expressed on the earth. And that's why we look to one another, to see that in us. That's why we want to grow towards maturity, so that the fullness of Christ can actually be seen in us, in the church. So, you know, I just think I've been blessed and encouraged and empowered. For now, I guess we're trying to work out. It's probably 15 years, maybe 13 or 15 years or something. So anyway, I don't know whether I answered your question, Craig, but you know, there's some thoughts.
Yeah, no, beautiful thoughts, and strongly the connectedness. That one thing that's a feature of John's apostolic grace is this open home and this open Zoom, if you like, in the context of now. Like, you know, the whosoever will may come, you know, and come and connect with no parameters on that. No, you know, you have to be here, this or that, or, you know, we're watching your percentages or there's no roll call, there's no, you know, it's just availability to come and relate with. And I just see grace upon grace in that, and authenticity of relationship. As well, and it seems like that's the way of the kingdom. I'm so glad you took a moment just to reiterate that every believer has the great gift of being able to hear the voice of God, and you know what, pre-Christians also have that great gift of being able to hear the voice of God. And as a believer, to boldly go into the throne of God and to make petitions and prayers and supplications and to be face to face with the King, in an atmosphere of glory is the portion of every saint, and that's not to be diminished. I'm glad that you made clear that is the portion and the inheritance of sons and daughters. But it is also that the way of the kingdom is the great prayer of Jesus, of oneness, of fitting together, of preferring one another, of mutual submission towards one another. And if it wasn't the way of the kingdom to have the leaders of the body of Christ, to have leaders, to have apostles first and prophets, and to have, you know, evangelists, pastors and teachers, if it wasn't the way, then I'm pretty confident it wouldn't have made its way into the Ephesian text and other texts as well that make reference in Galatians and so on. It is that this is how Christ has ordained for his body to be led and to function. And so by all means, enjoy the intimacy of throne room encounters that are afforded you as a son or a daughter. But also, let's pursue what it is to be connected to one another and to be able to be led by gifts that are given to the body of Christ. Pastor Tony, you're one of those gifts. You're one of those great gifts. I said it even last night again or the day before. I say it pretty often, but you have this great fathering influence that makes people feel safe, that brings a welcome to them to be able to be led in a way that is empowering and freeing, and that it reflects the kingdom dynamic of freedom as well. And this is a great grace for the region that we have. There are a number of senior leaders with grace to lead that way, and so important to remain connected, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. Relational connection. That's the expression of the triune God, really. You know, the church is just an expression of God himself, you know, and Christ being the head. And we really don't have much choice in that. And we don't have a great deal of choice about picking and choosing which ones we're going to relate to as well. I mean, it gets a bit tricky there. If you start setting fences and things, you know, we can get a bit pharisaical, like, you know, God gave 10 commandments initially, but the Pharisees were so concerned, they come up with over 600 so that nobody got close to breaking a rule, because we don't want to break a rule. Well, you know, if we start putting fences around the relationships as well, you know, it's got to stop. Yeah, and look, I know, I understand that at some point you do have to draw lines. You know, you know, there are, I guess, some guidelines, but boy, we've got to be really careful that we don't draw them too small. You know, we got to keep those relationships big and broad, you know, and allowing the grace of God to cover up all of our messes, you know, all of our misunderstood theologies or you know, even heartfelt, biblically based understandings of certain things within the church. We've got to really rely on God's grace and mercy to hold us, you know, together, even when we see these things as huge and difficult. Because I'd rather us beat sin and allow salvation, you know, for people outside the church to be the primary thing rather than us just getting it all right.
Amen. You're listening to 94.9 on the FM dial. That's Rema Central Coast. Some people jumped online, of course, and rema.cc is a great place to listen live. There's the phone app now, which I trust every person in Australia now has, so that you can listen to Rema CC in your pocket. That is an awesome, awesome resource, I got to say. There's so much stuff on the app. I've just loved it. I shared last week that the story on an old man Holden, the guy who came up with Henry Holden. And so that article was a revelation to me. I had no idea the guy, you know. Anyway, there's so much stuff in that app. And you can listen to podcasts on the rema.cc app as well, so you can listen to this conversation again, you know, a couple of days down the track. You'll just jump on and go, I want to hear what Pastor Tony Ray from Grace Community Church had to say. Well, then you can. This is the New Expressions program. Pastor Tony, it is such an honor, always an honor to have you on the program. I appreciate you as a fathering leader in our region. I have so much love and honor for you. And I thank you for your insight so far, just to unleash some joy that, according to some of our listeners, left them zonked, I think was the word. that's a theological term for whacked in the Holy Ghost. well, why not, eh? Why not? It's a good day to be whacked in the Holy Ghost. And meanwhile, we've been talking about all things kingdom, particularly oneness. And I just wanted to pick up on an idea from where we finished just before the break. This time that we're in, if Jesus' prayer of that we would be one, if this idea of abiding in him and the vine and John 15 is, if all of those things considered and then I can't help but see this time that we're in as an absolutely unique and magnificent opportunity in this day. Like it's a magnificent opportunity for the body of Christ to figure out oneness, to figure out how to submit to one another, how to abound in love towards one another, how to recognize apostles and prophets, pastors, teachers, and come in under submission to the great graces that they have to help us. There's such an opportunity in this moment, in these days. You know, there's a bunch of people praying together every night. You seem to be a frequent offender in that space. Again, another opportunity to manifest oneness, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, look, it's a beautiful thing. If you can get onto that 7 p.m. and you can leave your screen, you know, blanked out, you don't have to be called on to pray. You can even go to sleep. I was talking to someone the other day. If you go to sleep during that whole thing, I'm serious. Just by your presence, your decision, your determination to say, no, I'm going to join in. I'm exhausted. I'm going to lie down on my bed. I'm going to, you know, my sound's going to be off. My video is going to be off. And I said, even if you fall asleep, you know, God does all sorts of great things while we're asleep. You know, lots of great downloads have happened and dreams and visions and things. So I don't think it disconnects us, you know, if sleep is where we need to end up. But if you can get onto those prayer meetings, there's multiple congregations involved there, and there's no highlighting, low lighting of anything. There's no gaslighting of anything within the kingdom. It's a specific prayer meeting to pray while this lockdown's happening for people's mental health and businesses to survive and, you know, workers to be treated well and owners to, you know, to to hopefully flourish, if not now, in the future. You know, to be praying for the kingdom, you know, to advance on the coast through the testimony of the one church on the Central Coast. Lots of congregations, lots of expressions, but the one church. And we're being afforded an opportunity to work out how we, again, as believers, continue to walk with one another in Christ, because there are multiple, you know, there are multiple understandings or opinions on various things. I'm not going to name any of them, but in that in the mix of all that together, we're being invited, called by the Spirit, to stay so close to Jesus that when we see some of those opinions or those thoughts or those whatever they happen to be, if we could stay so close to Jesus that it was hard for us to look around him to see those things, you know, because every time we looked, you know, his face would be in our face, you know. If we could keep our gaze fixed on Jesus, so that it's really hard for us to see those differences. Now, they're going to be there, and who knows? There might be some rights and wrongs in it. You know, some bunch of opinions might actually be right, you know, and some might actually be wrong. But again, I wish that our eyes would be so closely fixed to Jesus that it's hard for us to see. And in the middle of it all, trying to work out how we pray together, how we love together, how we share the gospel together, regardless of some of those differences. And wouldn't it be beautiful to have those words said about us that are recorded in the scriptures about the early believers? Look how they love one another. They're not saying, wow, look how they understand everything the same in life, you know. That's not recorded for us. You know, they may have heard a whole lot of other things about the early believers, but we know that those outside the kingdom certainly saw. They saw power as well, and that put some fear into them. They saw miracles being worked. They saw power, which brought a little bit of fear, and I'm hoping that was holy fear in them. But the observation that's recorded for us is, look how they love one another. You know, look how they love one another.
That literally, that affection, that abounding in love towards one another, and it's like this is a season where we can do that so well. Having seen, you know, on Zoom, you know, we would love to be physically gathered together and hugging one another and so on, but on the screen, as it is, the restrictions are at the moment. But to see one another, and I love the idea, Pastor Tony, that you emphasised about, gee, log on to the Zoom and go to sleep if you need to, because immediately quickened in me was this understanding that your spirit's not asleep, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Your spirit can be present and even be making utterances that you're unaware of.
That is great. Spirit, Romans 16.
Come on. Yep. And so, you know, why not let's just take the opportunity that's afforded us to manifest the very oneness that Jesus was looking to. And I do agree. An environment where people are abounding in love towards one another, have such regard for one another's prayers. I don't know about you, but I sometimes feel like I know next to nothing when it comes to prayer, when I'm alongside of some of these magnificent saints who have been making petitions for decades. And I go, oh, I have so much to learn. And,
yeah.
and I feel increased and enhanced when I'm around these prayers. You know, these are good for me. My spirit is edified as I hear, you know, mature believers in Christ making their intercession on behalf of the region. These are good days for us, yeah?
Amen to that, yeah. They are good days. Yeah, so again, we can be trapped in the toughness of it all, and it is. You know, we can't diminish that. It is difficult in many ways for many people. However, we can't allow, just like any stage in history and you know, like we were talking about back with the joy, if we just allow our circumstances, you know, to dictate how we feel or how we perceive our faith or who we're prepared to mix with or not mix with or, you know, whatever. Again, we're short-sighted. You know, we've actually lost sight of Christ, you know, and his manifestation in the earth and how he wants to be manifest in the church.
Mm.
You know, we just, the eyes fixed on, one of the visions I've had a number of years ago, and I don't get many visions and dreams and things like that. In fact, dreams, I think I'm a non-dreamer, but everybody tells you have to dream. So if I ever get a dream, I will listen. But I had a real vision of the eyes of Jesus, you know, and it was a universal perspective in the sense that it was the eyes embedded in the universe, but the eyes of Jesus on the cross and the great love and compassion that was there and the expression of obedience that was in him. You know, he was obedient even to death on a cross. And I can still visualize those eyes, you know, just, and I can't describe them. I can't say that they were just beautiful or kind or powerful. I don't even try, but I can visualize them and I want my eyes to be fixed on those because I believe they were Jesus' eyes.
Mm.
You know, now that's a bit nebulous, you know, eyes, tell me what that means. I can't. But if you can't fix your eyes on Jesus' eyes, then fix them on him. Read the scriptures, you know, find out how he dealt with things in the New Testament there and in the Gospels. Lots and lots to be learned, and then look to mature Christians as well and see how they, you know, how they go. They won't be perfect. They won't tell the whole story, but they'll give you clues about how you say things and how you do things. And some you might even struggle still with, you know, and think, oh, I don't know, that's a bit too weak, you know, it's a bit compromising. And we have all these, you know, statements that we make, you know, it's always the buts. Someone will say something and they'll go, but, which just means you throw out everything they just said because they're going to come up with something contrary. But, no, look, keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, author and the perfecter of our faith. And, hey, who's without sin can cast the first stone? I don't know that I'm game enough. You know, I know we've got to identify sin. I know we've got to discern. I know we've got to be wise. I know we've got to make choices. But, boy, I don't want to quickly pick up stones. No. Yeah. Your thoughts, Craig?
Well, I, you know, it's so helpful. This is what fathers do. They correct us into the person of Jesus, and I love that about you. I love that you call us constantly to fix our gaze on him, the one who has never stopped gazing on us. You know, and I just deeply, it delights my heart to hear it. One last thought, Pastor Tony, you unleashed something a couple of nights ago in the prayer Zoom. I think, Evan, we need to probably put the link to the prayer Zoom up on the website or something, just so listeners can find it if they want to. There's a nightly prayer Zoom that's been going on every day since lockdown under an apostolic instruction. The apostolic or ascension gift leadership in the region thought there was a witness to pray on these specific things for the Central Coast during lockdown, so we've been faithful to that. And so therefore we've aligned apostolically in our prayers. Pastor Tony, you suggested we should pray and believe. Just 1 minute on pray and believe that we can leave the saints with today.
Yeah, look, it struck me. I was listening to something that John Alley was actually saying, and look, we just, as if we've got to do something, and then we know it's about being in relationship, but if we've got to do something, then choose to believe. Choose to believe that when you're praying, when you're loving, when you're doing the good works, choose to believe that God is able. Choose to believe that our prayers can be answered. Choose to believe that God is trustworthy, that he is holy, he will work it, he will work things out, he will bring to completion the things that he's begun. Believe. You know, I almost try and pray now as if, you know, thanking God for what he's doing because I'm believing that he's going to do it. You know, so brothers and sisters, if you can choose to believe when you pray and when you act in the name of Jesus, do it. Believe. He's believable.
Come on. A great word and an encouragement to the saints today. When you set your hearts to pray for something, then determine in your heart, and I'll believe you, God, that you're accomplishing this good work and your kingdom is advancing. This is the Hope-Filled Gospel. This is the New Expressions Program. You have been Pastor Tony Ray and will continue
to pray.
Thank you so much for having time with us today. We appreciate it.
Excellent.
Bless you all.
Thanks, Tony. We'll see you next week, folks.
You've been listening to an encore presentation of New Expressions, which can be heard live every Friday morning at 10 a.m. on 94.9 Rema Central Coast.